Okay, I don't write programs for real computers. Hardly anyone does. That's because the computers that do exist, called CPUs, follow painfully primitive instructions. Being a CPU is like doing taxes by hand. When the instructions say, on line 12, subtract line 10, from line 9, I don't have to worry about what the numbers or the lines mean. I just follow the instructions. If CPUs got bored, we'd be in so much trouble. But imagine writing tax forms for CPUs. You wouldn't be writing for a human being who knows over 20,000 words. CPUs understand a few instructions, and there's hardly any grammar. Making the instructions easy to use would have made the CPU slower, and who wants a slow CPU? So the language the CPU speaks is super tedious to write in. Wouldn't it be nice to write programs in English and have something like Google Translate translate it into the CPU's language? Then we could program imaginary computers that understood English. Well, Google Translate isn't as good as a human translator. Translations could come out completely garbled, or worse, subtly wrong. The problem is that words don't have just one meaning. You have to know about the context and even stuff about the real world to understand what they mean. Even logical words like if and or have lots of meanings. It's so bad that if I wrote a program in English, it wouldn't just be hard to translate. I wouldn't even know what I meant. What if we made a new language and picked just one meaning per word, and maybe made it simpler, too? Then we could build a translator that would be 100% accurate. Grace Hopper, a programmer for the US Navy, had this idea in 1952 and called it a compiler. The compiler she made translated programs in the nicer language into programs in the CPU's language. This is a cartoon about her compiler from a class she helped teach. At first, people thought that the idea of programs translating programs was ridiculous. Eventually, the Navy promoted her to Rear Admiral for her discovery. What makes a language so nice that it's worth the trouble to translate it? Programmers disagree, which is why there are thousands of programming languages, and even more compilers. But you don't need to understand the language in order to see how much nicer it is than the CPU's language. Here's a program in the CPU's language that displays the words to 99 bottles of beer on the wall. Figuring out what clumps of ones and zeros mean is actually the easy part. The hard part is that most of those clumps say things like, shove this thing around so that there's space for that thing. It's like the world's worst tax form. Here's a program that does the same thing, but in the programming language Python. It's still confusing, but at least there's some structure to look at. The instructions are 100% clear to the compiler, but on top of that, they help the programmer to specify every little detail clearly. She didn't just write it so that the imaginary Python computer would do what she wanted. She wrote it so that it's possible for me to understand what she did and even change it. You don't even have to know Python to figure out how to change it to sing 999 bottles of beer on the wall, or how to make it sing a song about bottles of beets. With a bit of experimentation, you can do a lot more. Aside from not existing, the Python computer is much easier to program than the CPU. And here's a program I wrote that does the same thing, but in the language called Racket. Even though the languages look very different, and even though I hadn't seen her version, we approached the problem in a similar way. The two languages kind of feel similar to each other. And here's another program to do the same thing, this time written in the language called Haskell. It looks quite a lot different, because Haskell makes different things easy to do. The author could have written the program so that it worked more like the Python and Racket programs, but in Haskell it felt better to do it this way. But no matter which language you use, it looks and it feels better than it does in the CPU's language. As someone who uses computers, I use CPUs. They're fast, they're reliable, but they speak an unbearably tedious language. But as someone who programs computers, I use imaginary machines that were made to be easy to use, and which help me clarify my thoughts. I even get to pick which imaginary machine I want to use today. It means that I spend less time going over minor details again and again, and more time thinking about the actual problem I'm trying to solve. Gracehopper didn't just discover a useful trick. She discovered the way to say something worthwhile to our machines.